Welcome to Norfolk Perspective City Slice. I'm Bob Batcher. And when you think therapeutic, what do you think about? Well, I think about Kathy Orlitsky because she knows it all about what the Therapeutic Rec Center is all about. How you doing?
I'm doing good. How are
you? You're still having fun, aren't you?
I am.
That's cool. And why are you having fun?
Well, because when you say therapeutic, of course, I'm with the Therapeutic Recreation Center mm-hmm. in Norfolk, and all of the programs that we're able to do and the people that we're able to work with, it's a fantastic profession. So it definitely brings a smile to your face.
Now, okay, but I've got to say, in with a lot of people that you're working with, some would say, oh, but you kind of see opportunity there.
Definitely. And I think with the awe, we like to remind people that what is so exciting is everything that everyone's achieving that we work with. We specifically work with people with disabilities. And what that environment creates is an environment where we can achieve so many goals, and people are working on strengthening and improving different skill levels. And it's really exciting to be a part of that.
Okay, now, because I have the opportunity by sitting in this chair of talking to a lot of people, and the ones that I find most intimidated about are the youthful ones that can really dance and have the rhythm, and they always talk about dancing, and they want to get me out of this chair, and I say, I can't do that. What do you say to somebody who comes in and says, I can't do that?
Well, the good thing is, out of our 50-plus programs that we have every week, we have a huge variety. So the leisure and recreational opportunities, there's so many different things for people to take part in beyond maybe dancing or even exercising, because some of those may be areas that people aren't as comfortable. Mm-hmm. We've got cooking programs and wellness, and we have all types of art programs and special events and outings where we're going out into the community and we're going on trips. So there's really something for everyone at our facility.
Okay, and then I'm going to call you out, and you're sneaky, because something tells me that as soon as that person plugs into something that they can do, mm-hmm. you're going to take them to the next step and discover mm-hmm. something else they can do. Right?
How did you know?
I just had that sneaky feeling.
It's neat the way that works, is that when somebody really does actually get out and participate in the recreation center, because sometimes the first initial goal is just having really the courage to come out into the community and participate. Maybe they've been at home. Maybe this is after a diagnosis or an injury, or maybe this is someone who's had a disability their entire life. There's some bit of courage sometimes in just reaching out and going out to their community center. And then when they get to the Therapeutic Recreation Center, they start participating in classes. They see the energy. They're making friends. They see it as such an awesome social arena, as well as working on all of the skills that they're working on while they're there and all of the goals that they're working on. They want more, and they want to try different things. And sometimes that courage leads to them being more motivated than we ever imagined, and they end up trying, yes, even the class that they weren't so certain about in the beginning.
So a loud message for the person that might be sitting home watching the show saying, I can't do that.
Right. The loud message would be, I bet you could, and why don't you give it a try?
Okay. Now, being inside and having classes and being contained to a building just wasn't good enough. You decided to venture outside and build an inclusive playground.
Yes.
I got to ask you, for those that haven't been over on Evans Street, what is an inclusive playground versus a playground?
Okay. Basically, an inclusive playground, we like to use the term in the inclusion world of universal design. This playground has many ramps and rails and support systems, as well as a rubber turfing that make it very accessible for anyone, really, of all ages. So we don't have to just think about someone with a disability. We can think about maybe parents or grandparents that may utilize a walker or a cane or a wheelchair, actually being able to interactively play with their children on the playground. Sometimes your traditional playgrounds have mulch. That's a huge barrier to somebody with mobility issues, mm-hmm. and therefore this inclusivity of this playground, having a rubber turf, having ramps that lead up to each play area, it allows everyone to be able to participate together of all ability levels.
And we're seeing in our community a changing in the community where in pre-tape you kind of very casually mentioned the mom or dad who came back from battle, mm-hmm. and before they left they were able to push their kid in the swing, and now maybe they can't.
Right. Maybe now that they've returned, maybe there is some type of diagnosis or disability or some type of impairment where maybe they are utilizing a wheelchair, or maybe they just have to utilize a cane, or maybe they have paralysis on one side, and maybe they're just having difficulty moving around. Well, what allows the accessibility is these ramps and is this rubber turf, a flatter play area, play surface where they can get right up close to their children coming down from the slide or walking through the different balance play areas that we have and doing the different interactive activities, and they can be right beside them even though their ability level is different.
So part of that whole I can't, mm-hmm. it can be fueled by lack of accessibility. So
Right.
And things as simple as playgrounds.
Right. And most importantly, the children can still have their parent or their grandparent, no matter how the aging process takes place. Just the aging process alone, sometimes our mobility changes. So now the children can still have all of those people present playing with them, as well as their friends from school that maybe have a different ability level as well.
Okay, there you go again. You talked about interacting on the playground. It's not a matter of grandma or grandpa bringing their grandchild to the playground and finding that bench to sit on.
Right, right. There are indeed benches.
You're
but
sneaky.
I know. The playground really does encourage that interactivity, which is really, really an awesome thing.
Which then becomes movement.
That's right. And so now you have all generations, you have the entire family unit, you have all of the children actively engaged in playing because it is all inclusive. So
that's
what
great.
It really does is truly in the definition of the title.
Okay, who's eligible to come and play on this playground?
Well, during school hours, it is definitely open specifically for Mary Calcutt Elementary for their students.
Okay.
But we are located the Therapeutic Recreation Center right beside the playground. So a lot of our participants that are in programming, we definitely share the playground area. But after hours, after school, really from dawn until dusk, they have the playground open for anyone in the community, for anyone at our recreation center, or anyone driving by that notices it. It's had quite a bit of traffic from all of those different areas.
Okay, let's kind of back up. How did this idea get born?
Well, I know that there was some aging playground equipment that was located in the same area.
That was nicely put.
Right. And so when the upgrade was being looked at, they really did address a more inclusive design idea, wanting to be Norfolk's first inclusive playground. They went to so many different angles to figure out which play areas would work. It has over 21 specific play areas, where 18 of them you can participate in by being transferred, and there's 13 that involve ramps and rails that are basically specific for anyone participating. So a lot of thought went into it.
Wow.
With it being beside our therapeutic recreation center, it really worked out well, of course, for our program as well.
Now, this came with an additional cost too, right?
It sure did. It did. The playground's over 3,500 square feet, but basically the cost was about $185,000 approximately for the playground. That rubber turf is what really makes the playground expensive. That's really the quality aspect to the mm-hmm. inclusivity, is having the non-barriers, having the turf so accessible to anyone, and that's really where the extra cost is, because the playground equipment is placed in the ground, and the rubber turf is laid around the playground equipment to anchor it really well and to have everything secure and safe.
Wow. Okay. Now, when you're not doing playgrounds,
mm-hmm.
who is the audience for the Therapeutic Rec Center? Who do you have in mind of serving?
Well, we serve anyone ages 6 and up with any varying level of disability. So I want you to think out of the box. I want you to think maybe someone who has severe arthritis and needs to exercise in a water environment, in an aquatic exercise class.
Mm-hmm.
We offer 6 of them, to maybe someone who has Down syndrome, or to someone who has a visual impairment or hearing impairment or cerebral palsy or autism. We have a wide array of programs, so we address all levels of disability, ages 6 and up, and primarily Norfolk citizens, but non-residents are able to participate as well.
Okay, now I'm going to kind of be a little behind the scenes.
Sure.
You brought some potential new Kathys with you. You have some interns.
Well, new, I should say, all of really our team, because they're being supervised by 2 of our staff. Trip and Melody at our center, other CTRSs, are supervising our 2 Hannahs. So we have an intern right now from Virginia Wesleyan and ODU.
If you were to say, what's the magic that makes it work for somebody who's entering into this profession? Why should they be in this profession?
Well, I feel that honestly, if you want to be a part of somebody's life truly transforming, when they experience either recreation that they used to do before diagnosis or before injury or before disability, or someone who maybe due to their disability, they've kind of given up on hope, or they've just kind of stayed closer to home, to see people actually reach out and grow and be challenged and learn new skills and participate in a really fun environment and make new friends, it's a really exciting thing to be a part of. So somebody entering the profession would really just want to enjoy something like that.
How about the mom or dad or the son or daughter that's dealing with somebody who's...
Yeah, for the parents, we definitely are really a support for them too, because our programming will provide in many ways respite for that family member, as well as it will also help them learn ways that they can work with their child or with that sibling. So for the whole family unit, therapeutic recreation really does assist in all of that.
I was sharing earlier that in pre-tape that VEC News did a story about the Admirals mm-hmm. taking some handicapped people that were in wheelchairs out on the ice at the rink.
Yes.
At MacArthur Memorial, MacArthur Center. And it was so cool because there was this kid who, I think he had CP, was just squealing while sliding around on the ice. And
right.
Just pure joy. Is that right. What you get every day?
It really is. And I think really what brings so much meaning to our job is that not only is it seeing people really experience life to the fullest and really attempt and try things maybe they never thought that they would enjoy or that they'd be able to do, it's almost more than that. It's really just giving and providing the general recreation and leisure experiences that you and I would want to everyone, even individuals with disabilities.
I've got a stepdad that has, or a dad, a father-in-law, who's lived in that world now of I can't.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 94, I can't.
Right.
What would you say to that? What would you say to his daughter and trying to get him out of that?
Right.
Recliner?
I would say to first maybe just keen in on certain leisure interests that person has that he's already interested in. And I'm sure you'll find a program similar at our center already being offered. And use that as a launching point to have that father come in and do an intake assessment with us where we learn a little bit more about him, find out other interests.
No major
areas.
Commitment for the next rest of your life.
Exactly. Just come in, just see the facility, see the different programs that we offer, meet the staff that really do all have a contagious enthusiasm, they really do. And I think that will then open his eyes to saying, okay, I might be able to try this. And I'm sure it will lead to other recreational experiences too.
And especially if you can tell him it's okay for a 94-year-old to play in the playground.
Most definitely.
That would be cool. Okay, I got one last thing I've got to say because I'm not sure if the viewer knows this or not, but the last time you were on the sofa, we had a big secret.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
You're not going to do this.
Yeah, I'm going
to
tell you because I'm going to tell the viewer that right after that, we had the pleasure of visiting you in the office when you were named the Norfolk Employee of the Year.
That was something. I was, yes, very surprised.
Well,
very
that was the best part about it. We kept it a surprise.
You did well because I was very surprised and very humbled and very honored. It was a very touching moment. So thank
well,
you.
Well, but Kathy, because you and the staff out there do represent the spirit of what we mean when we say life celebrated daily in working with the residents. So I want to say publicly thank you and take those two interns under your wing and teach them to become the future Kathys.
We'll do it. Thank you, Bob.
Okay, cool. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for being here.